Hello everyone, welcome back to Lilliputian Lessons. We've started a quizathon now, which is essentially a 10-day quiz in which serially people get eliminated, but you can still participate just for the, you know, sake of knowledge and learning. So this quizathon today, I'm going to explain to you the answers of quiz number one that was based on electrolytes. So without further delay, let's get started. So question number one, the question is, a 15-year-old male presents with hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, hypercalciuria and nephrocalcinosis. His blood pressure is normal. The likely diagnosis is. So here we need to know these monogenic forms of hypokalemia. So monogenic forms of hypokalemia will be basically, there are multiple, but in the perspective of entrance exams, there are three most important monogenic forms. Those are Bartter syndrome, Liddell syndrome and Gittleman syndrome. So let's see what the defect is and how these problems are caused. So as you can see, the four most important criteria in all of these problems are, there is a variation in pH, there's a variation in potassium, there is a variation in renin, as well as a variation in blood pressure. So before I go on to explain to you actually how these problems happen, I'll just tell you simple ways to remember, which is not necessarily a mnemonic, it's just a simple way to remember. So as you can see, Liddell syndrome is the only one where there is hypertension, right? So the other two have almost normal BP, but as you can see, there is normal or even reduced renin in Liddell syndrome. So why is it that renin is reduced and still there is hypertension? That is because the epithelial sodium channels are having a gain of function mutation. So when there's a gain of function mutation, a lot of sodium and water gets retained in the body and it's not excreted out in the urine. So when there is water retention and sodium retention in the body, even though that provides a negative, you know, feedback to stop more renin production, even then there's so much water you know, in the body that will cause hypertension. So it's more of a volume overload. Whereas in the other two, there's no such volume overload. So here in Bartter and Gittleman syndrome, earlier these two were classified under Bartter itself. But now Gittleman has, you know, been changed into a separate syndrome because of its genetic differences. So essentially what happens is, you all probably know loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics, right? So if you know the mechanism of action of loop and thiazide diuretics, it's very simple to understand Bartter as well as Gittleman syndrome. So in Bartter syndrome, what happens is there is a problem with the sodium potassium 2 chloride channel. So when there's a problem with that channel, so we know that the normal function of that channel is to take back sodium and potassium into the body in exchange for two atoms of chloride. But this is not happening. So what happens is there will be wastage of potassium. And because sodium is also getting wasted, sodium is a very precious ion in the body. So body will try to exchange sodium for hydrogen, and hydrogen will be lost. Because hydrogen is lost, then you will have metabolic alkalosis. I hope that's clear. A very similar thing happens even in Gittleman syndrome, but the transporter that is affected is not the same. It is the sodium chloride transporter. Like I said earlier, this will mimic thiazide diuretics. So again, here you will have normal BP, you'll have hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis. So these three syndromes are frequently tested in entrance exams. So it's quite important to know at least these basic details about each of these. Okay, now let's move on to the second question. Which of the following electrolyte abnormalities is not seen following the creation of colonic conduit? This is a urinary diversion procedure, and this is quite advanced. So for our entrance exam purpose, I will only tell you how much is required. So we know that urinary diversion procedures are procedures where the parts of GIT are used in the urinary system surgically. So stomach, jejunum, ileum and colon can be used for this procedure. Different metabolic abnormalities tend to happen with the usage of different parts of the GIT, because inherently these parts of the GIT have different acidic and alkaline environments. So without getting into too much of detail, I'll just tell you how to remember this quickly. So as you can see, this stepwise fashion in which the alkalosis, potassium and chloride are descending. So you should know that for the stomach, you have alkalosis. For jejunum, you have increased potassium. And for colon or ileum, since both of them show similar reactions, so colon and ileum, it's the increase in chloride. So the rest of it is reduced. Okay, so if pH is increased in the stomach, it will obviously mean that potassium and chloride will be reduced. On the other hand, in jejunum, it's the middle column which has increased. What is the middle column? It is potassium. So pH as well as chloride will reduce. So it is acidotic and it is hypochloremia. In colon and ileum, it is the last column which has increased. So pH will reduce and potassium will reduce. So it is hypokalemia and acidosis. So when they frame the question, it will be hypokalemic, hypochloremic, metabolic alkalosis for stomach. So it'll be a big sentence that way. So I hope this is clear. Now let's move on to the third question. The third question is about the usage of Nernst equation in physiology. Extracellular concentration of a positive ion which has a valency of 1 is 100 millimoles per liter, and the intracellular concentration is 10 millimoles per liter for the same ion. Using the Nernst equation, calculate the potential across the membrane for this ion. So using the Nernst equation, what we can do is we will leave out the sign in the beginning and we will just follow the equation. And with the equation, we know that it is 61, that is the common factor, divided by Z, which is the valency, and concentration, that is 100 divided by 10. So that will be log of 10, that will be just log of 10 is 1, so that will be 61. Now we have to decide which sign to use. So using common sense, we know that if an ion is greater concentration outside and it's a positive ion, it means it has all the tendency to get into the cell, but we need a positive equilibrium potential inside the cell to keep it outside. So obviously we know by logic that this ion is nothing but sodium. So therefore this ion, we will give it a positive sign, and therefore the answer will be plus 61 millivolts. I hope that is clear. We will go to the next question now. The striae vascularis generates endolymphatic potential. This is in the inner ear. What is the value of this and which is the electrolyte that is predominantly present in it? So this question has a combination of two questions. One, we have to know what is the value of the endolymphatic potential, and secondly, we also have to know which is the electrolyte that is causing this potential to be as such. So in this diagram, as you can see, the image is a bit blur, but nonetheless, this is perilymph. These two are perilymph, and this one in the scalar media is endolymph. So in endolymph, it is 80 millivolts, and that is predominantly due to potassium. It's one of the very few fluids which is rich in potassium, apart from intracellular fluid, of course. So here the answer will be plus 80 millivolts, and it is due to potassium. We'll move on to the next question. This is about digoxin toxicity. The question is, which of the following events are not known to precipitate digoxin toxicity? And the options are hypercalcemia, hyperkalemia, hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia. So in this we need to know that hypokalemia and hyperkalemia are commonly confused. So the important thing to remember is that hypokalemia causes digoxin toxicity, and digoxin toxicity results in hyperkalemia. So this one sentence is very important. So here we have a slide to show causes of digoxin toxicity: hypokalemia, hyperkalcemia and hypomagnesemia. I will just read this out and highlight the important ones for you. In hypokalemia, it is because there's increased digoxin binding, increasing its therapeutic and toxic effects. So if hypokalemia is more, we all know that it will bind more to the receptor, right? So it will cause toxicity. Hypercalcemia, digoxin enhances calcium absorption. As such, you know, digoxin is a inotropic drug. So if calcium absorption is further increased, then it will precipitate toxicity. Hypomagnesemia, it can sensitize the heart to digitalis induced arrhythmias. So that is a bit non-specific. Now we will go to the next question. This is a very commonly tested topic about the electrolyte abnormalities following massive blood transfusion. So which of the following electrolyte abnormalities is not seen following massive blood transfusion? A. Hypercalcemia, B. Hypokalemia, C. Hyperkalemia, and D. Hypocalcemia. So we tend to get very confused in this. So I will just briefly explain what are the possible complications of massive transfusion. So basically we should know that massive transfusion is transfusion of more than 4 units of blood in 1 hour or more than 12 units in 1 day. So complications will be hypothermia and acid base derangements, citrate toxicity leading to coagulopathy. Those are general things which you don't get confused with. Where you get confused with is the electrolyte abnormality. So how to remember that is, we should know that this citrate binds to the calcium in the blood. So whenever there is citrate toxicity, there will naturally be hypocalcemia. Okay. So thereby hypercalcemia is ruled out. So hypercalcemia cannot happen in massive blood transfusion, whereas hypocalcemia can happen. Now coming to hypo and hyperkalemia. So initially we are administering a lot of RBCs. So when there is a lot of RBCs, there's also a lot of hemolysis because of the storage conditions and so on. So there we have intracellular fluid of the RBCs coming out into the bloodstream of the patient. So there you will have hyperkalemia because intracellular fluid is rich in potassium. So hyperkalemia is seen. How is hypokalemia seen? It is just that after prolonged massive blood transfusion, these membrane receptors will get regenerated. Thereby compensatory, they will take in more potassium inside. So whatever potassium is left in the blood is also taken up in very transiently into the intracellular space. So even hypokalemia can be seen as a side effect. So hypercalcemia is the one which is not seen. We will move on to the next question. A 3-week-old infant is brought with incessant crying and projectile vomiting. An olive-shaped mass is felt per abdomen during attempts at feeding. Which of these electrolyte abnormalities may not be seen in this child? So from this case, we know that this condition is infantile or congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. So here the infant vomits out large amounts of acidic content of the stomach because the stomach contents are not able to move distally into the duodenum. So whatever acid is there in the stomach is being vomited out. So we know that acid contains hydrogen and chloride. So here, very logically, hypochloremia will be there because everything is being vomited out in the blood. Everything is being vomited out. Along with that, we also have metabolic alkalosis because hydrogen is being vomited out now. Hypokalemia is because there is already alkalosis, so the cells tend to withdraw all the potassium inside, so that causes hypokalemia. But here is the catch. Here they have paradoxical aciduria. One would think that because the body is already short of acid, the renal system would not throw out excessive acid. But the point in the human body that is to be considered is that sodium as an ion is much more valuable to the body than hydrogen. So in times of extreme alkalosis, the body tends to retain sodium preferentially more than hydrogen. So in the kidney, sodium is retained in exchange for hydrogen. Therefore, the patient will have paradoxical aciduria. Secondary respiratory acidosis is just a compensatory mechanism. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. which of the following abnormalities are not seen in the ECG of a patient who has hyperkalemia? This is a very standard question, ECG changes of hyperkalemia. So we'll just have a look at this sequence. This is the level of serum potassium, and this is the change which is expected to be seen in the ECG. So the first one is of hypokalemia. We will deal with that in a later session. As you can see, this is a normal ECG. Here, if the potassium is more than 6, you have tall T waves. If it is more than 7.5, you have wide PR interval and wide QRS complex. Okay, and of course tall T waves. And if it becomes more than 9, in which case it signifies very bad prognosis, here you will not have P waves and you will have what is called as a sinusoidal pattern. So here in our options, the second option is flattened P waves, which is seen, but the third option is PR shortening, that is not seen, right? So PR shortening is the false answer, thereby that is the answer to this question. Let's move on to the last question. A baby is born with ambiguous genitalia. Karyotyping reveals 46XX. Child is progressively weak and has recurrent episodes of vomiting. Which of these electrolyte abnormalities are likely to be seen in this child? So before explaining this topic to you, I just want you to be familiar that any baby with ambiguous genitalia and normal genotype, you should immediately think of congenital adrenal hyperplasia. In congenital adrenal hyperplasia, you will have four varieties based on which enzyme is predominantly deficient. The most common one will be 21 hydroxylase deficiency, followed by 17, followed by 11, followed by 3. So I will teach how to remember points in these four types of congenital adrenal hyperplasia very soon in another video. But for the sake of completion of this video, I'll just tell very briefly about 21 hydroxylase deficiency. As you can see here, 21 hydroxylase is here and here. Okay, so whatever is distal to 21 hydroxylase will not be produced. So I will mark those in blue. So you don't have aldosterone, you don't have cortisol, but what is in yellow you have. So you have testosterone. Okay, so what will happen is, because you don't have aldosterone, there is salt wasting. We know that aldosterone leads to the effect that is sodium stays, potassium flees. So if there is no aldosterone, sodium will not stay and potassium will not flee. So if sodium doesn't stay, then there will be hyponatremia. And if potassium doesn't flee, then there will be hyperkalemia. In cortisol, it is more to do with glucose and those kind of things. So in cortisol, if there is no cortisol, baby will tend to have more episodes of hypoglycemia, vomiting, recurrent crying and those things. Now the other important thing is testosterone. Testosterone is high in this, because all the progesterone, 17 hydroxy progesterone, everything is being diverted into testosterone production. So if it is a female child, there will be ambiguous genitalia at birth because of virilization. Whereas if it is a male child, at birth there won't be anything particularly visible in the genitals because it's a male phenotype and male genotype. But the male child will have precocious puberty later on during his childhood. So that is there are significant features like this even for 17, 11 and 3 hydroxylase, but I will teach these in a separate video coming up very soon. So I hope you had a good learning experience. Keep yourself subscribed to our channel Lilliputian Lessons, and I'll be coming up with this quizathon explanation for the next 10 days. If you're not a member of our Telegram group, please do join. It's by the same name, Lilliputian Lessons. So I'll see you soon. Happy reading.